start by introducing myself. My name is Niels Redijk. I'm going to do a talk on the Haiku desktop operating system today for you. There he is. I usually speak to more people, but the room is not quite as large. So if anybody cannot hear me, please raise your hand or point to me or make sure you hear me, because I hope I have a nice story. First of all, about this presentation, I sort of prepared a different kind of talk. Then yesterday I saw the kind of audience, so I tried to tech it up a little bit. It was more general. So I decided to build up the presentation as follows. First of all, I'll tell a little bit more about myself, about my professional life, and about my role in the Haiku project. Then I'll speak to you about the Haiku brand, what that is exactly. I'll explain in a bit. And then I'll give you a tiny peek into some of the technology, the cool technology we think we have and we think you might be interested in. So first of all, who am I? Well, my professional life, I'm a mathematics teacher on a secondary school in Rotterdam. I'm also a bachelor's student in media studies. I'm majoring in film. I'm currently writing my thesis. The subject is nudity in Dutch films and the Dutch identity, which I could also talk more or less an hour about, but I won't do that today. My open source history goes back, I think, to 2001. Might even be a bit earlier. I started in the Dutch translation team of the KDE project. I did both the interface and the documentation. It didn't completely satisfy me, and I wasn't a real coder, so I sort of decided to take a peek into a different direction. So then I came across the Haiku project, which was then still OpenBOS. Which I never tried BOS, but when I came across it, the tagline, recreating a perfect desktop operating system, immediately spoke to me. So that's why I was interested. I tried BOS release 5. B Incorporated was dead by that time, but we'll get to that. And I was immediately hooked. So I did a bit of odd jobs. I once, in all my naivety, started to write a USB stack, which I could not complete because of the lack of skills. So now I chose a nicer occupation. I'm writing the Haiku book. And the Haiku book is the book that describes the application programmer interface, which is quite, well, sounds simple because we already have the B book, but it requires a completely new insight, but I'll get to that. First of all, I want to talk to you about the Haiku brand. Notice that I use the word brand, not project or philosophy. I use the word brand. Why? In my opinion, these kinds of alternative operating systems, well, they're nice, but you will never get a big general appeal, in my opinion, especially not in a niche as a desktop, which is basically ruled by Microsoft and by Apple. Still, it's interesting that many people are tempted or lured or interested by Haiku. So I want to explain how I think that works. That's the Haiku brand, and there's a brand mix. But first, I'll tell you a little bit about its history. Haiku is a continuation of BOS. BOS was an operating system which was started just before the 90s. The company was founded by Jean-Louis Gasset. He used to work at Apple, but he wanted to try something completely different. BOS, at first moments, he tried to do the Apple trick, binding the hardware and the software, which created some very good ideas. His hardware was the PowerPC processor, which was a legacy of his previous job. The software was completely written from scratch, not based on anything, not based on Unix or Mac or Windows, completely from scratch, with some very interesting ideas which we'll get to. But then in 2001, around 2000, BOS R5 was released. And also, for the first time in its history, B did an Intel release, and they also provided a personal edition which could be downloaded for no charge. And the best thing about the personal edition was that you could install it on your computer and on your Windows, from the start menu in Windows you could automatically boot into BOS, which was good. But then B Inc. Saw the light. They thought the next big thing is going to be internet devices. Well, they were right. They were only 5 years early. So by August 18, 2001, BOS went bankrupt. Or B Incorporated went bankrupt. The intellectual property was sold to Palm Incorporated. And B Incorporated continued to exist, but only to fight a legal battle with Microsoft. Which they settled, I think, 2 years ago for undisclosed amount of money. So what followed? Immediately at the announcement of the end of BOS, the Open BOS project was started, probably inspired by open source movement, Linux in particular. Another thing happened. There was another company, a German company, which bought the rights for BOS. At least they said they bought the rights for BOS, called YellowTap. And they created Zeta, or whatever they might pronounce it in German. anyway. That project continued. They released several revisions. The project continued until the beginning of the year, and then that company went bankrupt as well. It was never clear what the exact nature of the relationship between B Incorporated, or Palm at that time, and YellowTap was. First instance, we only thought it only appeared they had the rights to redistribute the Alpha operating system, which B was working on, which was called Dano. Later on, they modified the source, and still a bit later on, people from Axis, who then bought the assets from Palm, said they weren't aware of any contract between B Incorporated or YellowTap. That's all history now, but it's a bit of information you might be interested in. Haiku is currently still continuing. We are approaching an alpha release, but I'll talk about that later. Syllable was never or is not directly related to BOS. It might be inspired, but Syllable has never been. There have been some other clones. There was Cosmo, which intended to recreate the B application in program interface on Linux. And there was another project which attempted to do something similar. But Syllable was never directly related. I think Syllable is based on FAOS or. Yeah. Never directly related, as far as I know. Okay, I'm talking about the hike. Oh, question?
Small question.
Okay.
There was a legal issue between Microsoft and B Incorporated.
Yeah, there was a legal. Yeah. It was about B argued that Microsoft sort of claimed the master bootloader or the MBR. And that for that reason they couldn't, and they also had contracts with the manufacturing companies for computers that they could only install one operating system, and B wanted to make deals with those companies to make a dual boot solution, but they couldn't do that legally, and that was what the argument was about. And it lasted until fairly recent, I don't recall the year, but then they settled and we never heard from it again. Okay, pillars of the Haiku brand. The brand. I'm talking about a brand because there are several different things that interact with each other. First of all, there's the product. Second of all, there's a philosophy. And there's the community. And these three things, they sort of remind me of other brands. For example, you can draw a parallel with the Nike brand or something like that. How do brands work? Well, first of all, I want to talk about the product from the user perspective. Haiku has a clean and responsive user interface. A small memory footprint, the complete operating system uncompressed is 60 megabytes at this moment in time. There's a visual consistency, well, one might argue because there aren't a lot of apps for it yet, but there is at least a visual consistency right now. There's a certain continuous line of usability, which you'll notice when you use it. I might show something in a bit. And it's very extendable because the operating system is very modular. So as a developer, you can hook in all kinds of add-ons to the existing applications and system services, and by that way extend. For the developer, there's also an interesting part of the product. BOS was the operating system that introduced easy and effective multi-threading. Yesterday I watched a presentation on KDE 4 and I saw something on a thread manager and a job manager, and very interesting, but the problem is that X is still a single thread event loop, and BOS actually isn't, is more advanced. I'll come to that later when we go to the technical part. The other interesting thing is the clean and integrated application program interface. Well, I must admit there isn't much backwards compatibility necessary. We had the pleasure of breaking it every major release because they were always in a sort of testing phase. So there wasn't a big application base or a big user base that depended on applications being available. But still, this led to a very clean and integrated interface, which we are actually reproducing. There are for us developers, there are very nice tools. There's a translation kit, which is designed to input any kind of data and output to another format. We stopped at images. They did provide the infrastructure, for example, for text. What we now have is a translation kit that, for example, can convert RDF files to styled edit files, which is sort of the native Haiku simple text markup language. But also images, and it's very transparent. Haiku partially implements the POSIX standard. We don't intend to do it all, but it's need to implement basis. So if there's any particular range of functionality missing and there's a POSIX specification for it, we implement it. And also in case we want to port a particular part of thing of software, we can implement it. And for the developer as well, the extendability. Well, you might say this is nothing new. And I agree, there are many more operating systems, small project, hobby project, but also macOS X, which has macOS 10, which has the same same product features. So there must be something more to Haiku which appeals, which is where I come to the philosophy. Well, the point is arguable whether or not it was the intention of B Incorporated to actually keep it simple. One might say there was just a lack of time and the pressure to keep coming out with new releases. The result has always been that the Haiku or BOS was simple. And that's sort of the feeling, the sense you get when you use the operating system. One of the, well, it's almost an anecdote. The installation process was of BOS R5 was you pop in the CD, you click on the installer, it has a small partition tool and it has a nice tool that installs the boot manager, but the actual installation is merely copying all the files from the CD to the hard drive. Simple. No configuration needed. It also applies to hardware. Drivers are designed in such a way that they automatically publish devices to the system, and the system services are designed in such a way to pick up on those devices. Well, hooks. Also, something we try to propagate is the don't give all the options, but stick to good defaults and have a little bit of leeway with configurability. Modular and extensible. BOS was very extensible. I'm going to skip on detailed description here because I'm going to get back to it with add-ons and replicants. The last part, the third point, is to stay focused. Stay focused that we're actually trying to create a desktop operating system. The interesting thing was the fact when you tried BOS, it felt responsive. Your Pentium 200 turned into a lean, mean machine. Was it because BOS was so advanced or so wonderful and multi-threaded? No, not really. The kernel was actually quite, well, archaic. But what the kernel developer once said is the booth of the guy that developed the graphical user interface and the kernel developer were next to each other, so they could hang out and make decisions which might compromise certain other users, but it directly focus on the desktop use. That's the philosophy. The third pillar is the community. The community is all the people that believe in the philosophy. And it's quite a mixed crowd. Nowadays, there are a legacy of BOS users, but there are also quite a large group of people who are new, who have found out, who are fed up with the Linux desktop, so to say. I'm not, but no offense. But anyway, these people sort of strive for the same goal. And one thing that I feel is very positive about this community is that it's open and supportive. Just try to post on one of our mailing lists or one of the forums. People will help you out. They will. The problem is it's a small crowd. I dare not say numbers. I don't know the numbers of lurkers on mailing lists or people that follow the news, but it's a small crowd, so that's partly why I'm doing a speech, because I want to activate people. So that's the Haiku brand, and it's a brand because all things stack together. Well, I wanted to give a small demonstration, which I sort of have the feeling might fail, but nevertheless, it worked at home. So I'm doing it virtually because my development machine is rather big to bring here.
You can still install it on a PC, can you?
Yeah, you can. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, well, this is the boot screen. Interesting thing is that BOS used to boot, there's the desktop, in about 20 seconds after the boot manager. There we are. Remember, this is on virtual hardware. Well, we're here. This is the tracker. Tracker is the finder or the explorer or the conqueror or whatever you might call it. Haiku is not yet multi-user, but it does have a nice home folder. I wanted to try Vision here with you, but it froze last time on me, so I'm not doing that. But we have Vision, which is an IRC application. Standard are the mail daemon, which is a tool that fetches email. Interesting about Haiku is that everything is stored on the drive as files, including the email. And it has attributes, which I'll come to later, which are very flexible. I'd like to stick to this because my time continues to run. I'd like to go to an insight into the technology. I guess most of us are here technical crowd people. Yeah. Okay. Short overview. The kernel is very, very modular. Drivers, but also bus managers, so USB, Bluetooth, FireWire, everything is an add-on module. Even networking is simply add-on module. So the main kernel is very small and mean. It's not a micro kernel, but it's very, very small. It's very extendable. Interesting about the kernel is that it supports multi-threading from the ground up. And what does that mean? It has a few concepts which might seem common, but are implemented in such a way that they aid the extreme multi-threading model. There are ports. Ports are buffers, shared buffers, which you can put data into, and another thread can pull data out of it. Interesting thing is that they are global, a global namespace. So when we get to the blooper class, we'll understand what that means. But effectively means that any application can pass data to any port, which is linked to any other application. Semaphores are at kernel level, which is regular, and we have areas or shared memory. Also designed in such a way to be interoperable between applications. Then on top of that, we have the server architecture, which is not server in the traditional sense of the word, but all the different parts of Haiku are divided up in services. There's the application service, which provides the GUI. There's the input server, which provides input, which registers input methods. Devices and methods, for example, Japanese, and passes it on to the application server. We have the register, which makes sure that all the files on the hard drive are MIME typed. It's also aware of all the applications on the computer, so you can give it a MIME type and it will automatically launch that application. And there's a debug server and so on. Servers are separate applications. In theory, you could design it this way, that currently any server or almost all servers can crash and restart it, except for the application server and register. But in theory, it would be possible to design these in such a way that you might be able to do that. Is there a question?
Yesterday, I tried Haiku in VMware, and I ran PS.
Yeah.
I got a list of all the processes.
Yeah. I have no idea. We will find it out in a minute. I'll check it out for you when I'll do another demo. Interesting. I'm interested in it. So that's the server architecture. And on top of that, there's a complete library of classes. And these classes are divided up in kits. And kits are associated with a certain area of interaction. There's the application kit, which provides the groundwork for all the applications and also the groundwork for the messaging. There's the interface kit. We've got the network kit. We've got the media kit. So all kits are self-contained, but in such a way they do interact with all the other elements in the interface. So that's the technology overview. I want to do a more in-depth view of three different areas. Ah, it's because VMware is running. Okay, well, here we are. I want to go into multi-threading, what makes it so special. I want to go into the file system, the OpenBFS, and I want to go into the extensions, the add-ons. First of all, multi-threading. I just named all the three basic building blocks in the kernel. And now I'm going to mention the higher levels. Multithreading is implemented in the application kit. A large part of the kit is based around messaging. Well, messaging is based around messages, or specifically the bMessage class. Messages consist of, at least of one data member, which is sort of the identifier or the what code, which is a four byte code, which can be programmed to whatever you like. The system defines a certain set. You can define your own set for your applications, and you can publish these codes for other applications to interact with you. Messages can also have data members. These data members are typed, so they're, for example, they're strings, or they're B points, or they're messages. The message is aware of what types of data it contains, and so it's very powerful. If you, for example, have a networking thread and your main thread, you can say, well, we have this certain code, and this always has the data stored in the member data, and it knows how to retrieve it. Then there's the metadata. Specifically, messages know where they come from. They're self-aware, so they know where they've been sent from. They know whether or not the sender requires a reply, and they are perfectly aware of what route they took. And what they have been, or if in case they are a reply, what they have been a reply to. So messages are very functional. The application kit also has two main building blocks. There are bhandlers, and bhandler is an interface class which is inherited by all classes that can handle messages. A good example is the views. Views are the interface elements. And the interface elements know how to handle and process messages. The other interesting part is the B looper. And the loopers are sort of the janitors of a thread that continually runs to receive messages from a port. And in case there's a message, it passes it on to the appropriate handler. What makes Haiku applications unique is that every window, for example, is derived from Blooper, so runs in its own message thread, so in its own thread. The application runs in its own thread. So in a certain way, you get a lot of the infrastructure for messaging for free, because that's the way the applications are designed, which is different, for example, from X applications, which always are bound by the single thread event model. All those classes provide proper locking. They do require a manual, but every form of implementation does, but it provides a way to efficiently and securely, or relatively securely, implement these multi-thread applications. That's multi-threading. The file system, remember this file system was probably, I think, introduced, and I'm guessing now, so don't, I think in the late 90s. It was already 64-bit, it was journaled, it was built specifically for large files, such as multimedia files. And the interesting thing is that it's sort of, in a database-like fashion, it supports extended attributes. Also metadata. Interesting about that is that this was far before the whole revolution of desktop searching. What do you think of metadata? Well, there's a space for the file, and attached to the space there's a vertical database-like hash that contains data members. And these data members are typed, so the file system is perfectly aware of what type these messages or these attributes have. Interesting is that every file has a MIME type, so there's no need for extensions. All the files know what type they are, and the register knows which applications support what file types. I'm going to do a demonstration in a bit, but first I want to say the following. Because when you've got a database-like file system, you also want to be able to extract information from it. So that's where queries come from. And these are, well, they're not really based on anything. You can say they're formulas. And queries have the special are handled by the file system that implements the extended attributes. The interesting thing is that they are continually live updated by the file system. So this means that whenever you add a new file or you change an attribute and you have an open query, you can find the new file in a query.
So it's a bit like WinFS, which was
happening. Yeah, yeah.
10 years before.
Yeah, yeah, sort of, yeah. And it works. Well, it has been seen by people and stuff.
The license
It's MIT, didn't I say that? Oh, I'm sorry, it's MIT. I want to continue, questions at the end. No problem. So for example, to search for contacts, you can, for example, look for emails. You can say you want a meta type of email. What that means, I'll show in a bit. And then you can put in a string. Another cool thing which has been done is you have an instant messaging which stores all your contacts as files and adds attributes to it based on, for example, their status. So within the file manager, you can sort of have your overview of all your online or offline contacts. I think I'm going to demonstrate this. Yes, I am. Let's see if it wants to load. Okay, here we are. I made a few files in advance. Well, as Steve Jobs also always has a backup computer, I just have to crash it. And restart. What I wanted to show was the following. I wanted to show I have contact files, people files, and I want to show these in Tracker. So that's the file manager. And Tracker is aware of the special attributes and is able to work with these. And I also wanted to show the live query. But that it's a good thing Haiku boots so fast. It's quicker than VMware.
Why are the leaves in the name of Haiku?
Well, funny you ask. There's recently been an investigation in the origin of the logo. And apparently someone, well, we don't quite know whether they're feathers or they're leaves. They used to look more like leaves, but now they sort of look like feathers. So they've been sort of through a transformation. I think it refers to, well, both leaves and feathers have the association with soft and twirling down. And so I guess, I hope it's something like that. Okay, here's my home folder. Here are my people files. Well, this looks like normal files. You can see the size of the files is actually zero. That's because all the data is stored as attributes. When I click here on attributes, I see that the finder or the tracker, understands, hey, these are people files. So you can view special data. So for example, let's say I want to see what city all my people are from. Well, Dave is from Odiapil. That's nice. Or I can say, well, put on the email. Oh, I only have two emails stored. Now I want to look for family, so I choose find, and I want to find people by name. No, yeah, name contains. Well, here's my. I'm twice in here. Here's my brother. Now, for example, I want to add. Where is people? I'm going to add my mother. This is supposed to happen real quick. there it is. I can save her. And here, in this little view, she would pop up as soon as it's saved. But it's quite slow right now, so I'll continue talking and we'll see it pop up eventually. So those are live, which means they are automatically updated. Is it saving yet? It's crashed again. It works. Good. So that's that. All applications can use this, and you can use the different attributes yourself. So all in all, it's an interesting technology. Unfortunately, B Incorporated died before it could actually have a very meaningful implementation. But I hope you can smell, taste the possibility. Like Jean-Louis Gasset used to say, my nipples get hard thinking about all the possibilities. I hope you have the same. Okay, I'll quickly pass through add-ons now. Add-ons are, like you know, is dynamically loadable code. And add-ons are everywhere, virtually everywhere. There's kernel add-ons, there are the drivers, the bus managers, the network stack is one collection of add-ons because all the network stacks is all modules connected, interconnected to each other. Graphics add-ons. There's a tiny bit of the graphic driver in the kernel. And the rest is all in as an add-on to the application server, which is to increase stability in the kernel. And it works really well. You can have input add-ons. The tracker can handle add-ons. The philosophy was to keep it as simple as possible, but to give you the flexibility to be able to change whatever to change things into whatever you want. They introduced a different technology, which might seem. Are you familiar with K-part? Well, the KDE part technology embed different documents into your own. BE did it in a more, even more fundamental way. They created replicants. Replicants are add-ons, but in essence, they are serialized apps inside applications. If my VMware copy was working, I'd show you. I can't at this moment, so I'm sorry. But you, for example, have the desktop calculator, which is an application. But you can drag it into another application or on the desktop, and then it permanently lives inside the inside that application. Now, why does this work so well? Because with the B Looper architecture and the B Handler architecture, everything is self-contained, and you can communicate with it in a very efficient way. It's like tiny black boxes, but really, really black. Not you need to know how to a bit to interact, but really black. You can just send messages and they can handle them or they can ignore them. This sort of, starting with saying this is not another Unix implementation, sort of smells like Unix because it actually allows task separation. It allows a lot of interesting possibilities in theory. Unfortunately, B died before we could actually see if these meaning implementations could be found. Okay, I want to round up I want to start a sentence with honestly. Honestly, I don't think Haiku will ever be a viable desktop operating system in the sense of the word. Viable as in everyday, day-to-day work, enterprise work. It's a project, it's a dream, it's an ideology. It's a brand, but it's not a concrete project yet, and I doubt it will ever be at the same level, for example, the Mac or Windows will be. I have the same reservations for KDE, so if they ever succeed, I take back all my words and I will make it happen. So I don't believe in the end product just yet. It's a hobby, it's interesting. But why am I so attracted to it? Well, that's the brand, people. It's the brand. It's just like Nike shoes. I mean, they're cheaply made in China. You can just buy from the, well, what do you have here, the Bristol. But still, it has an added value. It has the sense of belonging, the sense of community, because all your friends are wearing it. And it also has the sense of an ideology. Ideally of being sportive. Well, this is sort of the same with Haiku. It's the ideology of being Haiku, being flexible, being simple, being extensible. It's all that. And the third thing, what makes Haiku interesting is that many of the technology we are seeing implemented in operating systems these days were first, or at least implemented in a decent way in BOS earlier. So which sort of makes it a pity we never had the time to work out all the power of the attributes. I slightly hinted at the IAM kit, which is amazing a smart piece of design. The people files actually turn to green or to red whether or not someone is online, and you can use the tracker to manage your contacts. It's a concept. It's a new concept because you can work in your same in your own tracker environment, which you know. So that's why I think the technology is also interesting to develop as a hobby, but still interesting. Finally, I'd like to thank the Haiku developers. Well, I think I'll take that back for hopefully getting me a stable build. Well, I hope they can make a stable build for you. I'd like to thank Jean-Paul and Jeroen and all the volunteers who are making this possible. And I want to thank George Mayer for the flyer, which I hope you have all seen, and else I'll put it through. Are there at this point questions?
How is network integration done? I mean, is it, for example, possible to share your file system, your file database with multiple Haiku?
Yes. One of the developments implemented a networking. You were asking about networking. I have to repeat for the video. You were asking about networking, and can you share your essentially share your BFS attributes? And yes, you can. One of the developers created a sort of network file system, which is attribute aware. Also, emailing files. The standard default bmailer flattens out all the attributes to a file and sends them when you send a file to someone else. So in that sense, yes, you can share data.
And also, can messages also go over the network? Like messages like
email? No, but I mean, it would be fairly simple by writing a replicator. I don't know exactly what it entails. I'm not a developer, but at the moment, it's not implemented in such a way. But it's interesting and. The format makes it possible, so yes.
Well, B-Share works a bit.
Sorry?
B-Share, the application.
B-Share. Yeah, B-Share, actually, yeah, that's a good example. That's an application which was explicitly point-to-point file sharing with extensible attributes. Thank you. Was there another question? Sir, back. That's very technical. The Haiku scheduler, the BOS, I read in an email by the original kernel developer who worked on scheduling. He said BOS scheduler was very crude. It worked because it made certain assumptions and it did certain tricks, but if you did something else, you would immediately, notice it. Haiku is currently in the process, during the Google Summer of Code, someone took on upon him the major task of designing a scheduler, which he's currently implementing. So I can't really tell you, the current scheduler isn't that good. It's just fairly basic, but the new scheduler is supposedly designed by someone who is very interested in the subject and who has designed something which apparently, or is supposed to work properly on a desktop, but time will tell. Your question.
You said it's currently in a single user system.
Yeah.
And any application can send any data to any other application.
Yeah. Ports aren't protected.
I'm sorry?
Ports aren't protected. Only kernel ports are protected, but the rest isn't.
So there's some kind of roots user idea.
Yeah. BOS wasn't multi-user. Haiku is a re-implementation. Now recall, I didn't say this explicitly, but Haiku is actually designed to re-implement all B interfaces and in a binary compatible way. So all applications will work on your Haiku. And it's because BOS wasn't multi-user, Haiku isn't either. It's on the to-do list. I don't find it that important, but there are probably people who are willing to work on that. So it's in the future. No, it's all it's like you're running as a root user or It's not intended as a secure OS. That's why it's an idea. It's a project. You had a question, I think.
Yes. So you said you were working on a book.
Yeah.
Planned end date or plan?
No, it's work in progress. Currently, it's very intensive because the original B book, which describes the interfaces, is it's copyright. It's not open. So we're actually doing a double translation because the developers took the B book, wrote the classes. And now I'm looking at the code and determining what it's supposed to do from that. So it's actually a double translation happening to prevent any copying or copyright infringements. So in that sense, it isn't going that fast. Currently, the support kit, which is a sort of general title utility class kit, is finished. And application kit is work in progress. And several Haiku-specific subsystems, such as the file system add-on interface and the USB interface, are already documented. But that's work in progress. Question?
How does it compare to Syllable? Can you say something about
that? I haven't tried Syllable, so I dare not.
Okay. If I install the Haiku, can I boot it from GitHub or something?
Yeah, you can. There are detailed instructions. We don't provide an installation CD just yet because it's in pre-alpha and you really need to know what you're doing, but this is the right crowd. Go to the website, which is here. And you can find enough instructions to build it yourself. You don't even need to have BOS. You can do it on Linux or whatever.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
I saw you using VMware to run it within, but it can also be run from a free hardware emulator.
Yeah, it can. Okay. Yeah, a Q emulator. Okay. That works. Right. It also has instructions. A question?
Is it possible to install third-party applications?
Sorry? No, yeah, you can. It's possible to install Firefox. It works, although not great, but that's more Firefox than something else, I would say. But so it's possible, so you can browse to the software sites. One of the biggest is BBits, and you can download whatever you want, and 95%, or the target is that 95% should work. And currently, the most glitches are interface glitches, so we make certain assumptions on positions of interface elements, which B apparently did a bit different. So you might notice interface glitches, but if you file a bug, they're usually fixed in quite a reasonable amount of time. Question?
SSH work?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Both client and daemon?
I don't know about the daemon.
Okay.
I don't do daemon.
It's a desktop. So
Yeah. Okay, apparently you can download and open the server. What might not be completely clear, Haiku is, you can't separate the GUI from the kernel. So it's not, you can, but it doesn't have a layer in between. So there's no terminal you can default go to. There's a terminal emulator.
And Bash.
Yeah, Bash. So, but it's not, so it should work, but. I haven't tried it. Do we have time for one more? Yeah?
Well, I was looking yesterday at Haiku, and it looks like Haiku is using ELF binaries, ELF binaries.
Yeah, it is.
Was that an original feature of BOS itself?
Yes, it's for binary compatibility. We're also still using GCC 2.95.3 with some fixes. It's possible to build it with 4.3 we're currently at, but we at least want to deliver the first release completely binary compatible at all cost. Okay.